I'm going to introduce our next speaker, who's well-known to all of you. Our next speaker is Jeanne Meserve. Jeanne has covered Homeland Security and Biosecurity for CNN since both those fields came into being in 2001, as long as any other reporter in the country. And many of us remember her coverage, her reporting, her superb reporting at critical times, such as during Katrina and during the DC sniper crisis. Before she was in Homeland Security, she was an international correspondent, covered events around the world. She's won numerous awards for her work and is now a senior fellow at the George Washington University Homeland Security Policy Institute and a member of the Aspen Institute Homeland Security Group. And Jeanne is about to come through this secret passage. Anyone who's speaking today, I want to let you know that there's a brown secret passage right here that comes out here, and I give you Jeanne.
Tom, thanks for that generous introduction. Good afternoon. I don't want to upset your stomachs when you're eating lunch, but we wanted to start today with a video that takes you back, however briefly, to those events 10 years ago. We can roll that. Most of us knew nothing or next to nothing about anthrax, and although some people had covered disease outbreaks, very few had any sort of experience with a possible biological attack. And it was shortly after 9/11, and frankly, we, along with the rest of the country, were edgy. But it was also different because the media was part of the story. We were among those targeted. It was personal for us. And it was potentially dangerous for us to cover the story. We sent a crew to cover a press conference at the Brentwood Postal Facility. That turned out to be a very bad idea. The location turned out to be contaminated, and our camera crew and producer ended up having to go on Cipro. It made you think twice, or three times, or four times every time you went out the door to cover another white powder incident. And you will recall there were many of them, and there continue to be many of them every day in cities like Washington, D.C. I think the attacks would have been a huge story in any event, whether or not the media was involved. Just about everybody was concerned. Everyone was worried. There were deaths. You, I'm sure, remember everybody clamoring to get Cipro and how nervous people were about retrieving their mail. The situation was made worse, though, and I would posit that it made it much worse, by conflicting and contradictory information coming from government officials. You heard some of it in that short video. We were whipsawed day to day, sometimes hour to hour. You know, we first heard that that Florida case was an isolated one until anthrax showed up in Washington and it showed up in New York. We were told the anthrax was weaponized, and then, well, maybe it wasn't weaponized. Postal workers were told they were safe, and then two of them died. Don't worry about the mail, we were told. Then a couple of people appeared to die from cross-contamination, and the instructions on handling the mail changed. It wasn't at all clear who was in charge, and it became apparent that those who appeared to be in charge didn't always know what they were talking about. This wasn't just a public health disaster, it was a communications disaster. I'd like to think we all learned from it, but I'm not sure we all took away all the lessons we should have. Look at what happened in Katrina as an example. It was a very different kind of crisis, but again, officials didn't gather the information they needed to properly evaluate the situation and calibrate their response. Even days after the storm, they showed a lack of understanding about what was happening. And we all know what the consequences were: a slow, inept government response, an unspeakable tragedy, and I would argue, an erosion of the public's trust in its government. People sometimes ask me, well, in a situation like Katrina, in a situation like anthrax, we've got a developing situation here. How should officials handle it? First, it would help, I think, if officials had some media training. I gather that is not a part of the curriculum in most public health programs. It probably should be. But the basics are pretty simple. To tell the truth and tell it to a straight, don't try to sugarcoat reality and give false assurances. Tell us what you know, and tell us what you do not know, and tell us, if you can, what you have ruled out. A story from a different sphere. When the space shuttle Columbia exploded over Texas, I was at home that day. I was oblivious to what was happening. But the spokesperson for the Department of Homeland Security called me at home to tell me proactively We know that this was not a shoulder-fired missile because of the distances involved, because of the altitudes. Now, at the time, you may recall, there was a lot of concern about Al-Qaeda getting hold of shoulder-fired missiles and using them against airplanes. The fact that he reached out to me and gave me this information stopped hours of possible speculation on our air and on other networks' air about whether or not the tragedy of the Columbia was a terrorist act. It was one preemptive phone call. That's all that it took. So what did the media take away from the anthrax attacks? Well, it raised a lot of questions that hadn't been asked before in our newsrooms and amongst those of us who are reporters. What kind of risk are you willing to assume? Could you opt out of a hazardous assignment? Would your priority be your family, or would it be your job? Did we need special training? Did we need special gear? What were the legal liabilities for our countries? The answers in our newsroom at CNN, you could opt out of a hazardous assignment without any sort of penalty. And some of us, so-called GO teams, did get some hazmat trainings. We got hazmat suits. My suit, by the way, became a big issue with my family. My kids teased me, half joking, that if something were to happen, if there were a massive chemical release, I was going to suit up and I was going to be safe, but they were not. Something they still tease me about to this day. In addition, I hope that news organizations learned a little bit more than they had before about science, and hopefully that will better inform our reporting if and when there is something comparable to the anthrax attacks. Hopefully, we build up our Rolodexes so we can call informed people like the people in this room for your input and opinion. And hopefully, though I must admit I'm less certain about this, we will strike the right tone. So we will inform the public without panicking the public. And hopefully, the public is going to be willing and able to listen to what we say, and more importantly, to what you say. There couldn't be a more important time to get it right. We have a little bit of time for questions if any of you want to ask me anything about the media, anthrax. I think it has pluses and minuses. Certainly there's the risk that a lot of bad information will get out and will spread very, very quickly, far and wide. That's the downside. On the upside, I think it helps us and it helps you get a handle on what's happening. To be perfectly frank, when I'm deployed now on a breaking news story, I immediately go onto Twitter and make sure I'm going to get the right feed so I can get input from people on the ground about what they're seeing in their environment. One of the great disadvantages in being a television reporter sometimes is that we are tied to a specific location. We have to, let's say, do live shots every hour on the hour, and you've got a limited visibility on the situation. Whereas if you're monitoring a Twitter feed and you have a chance to then make phone calls to confirm the information you're seeing on Twitter, it can be an incredibly valuable tool for getting situational awareness. The same holds, I'm sure, for everybody who's a health professional here. But it is certainly a much diversified situation. We do not control it the way we once did. And there is a risk, there is a downside that bad information will get out, certainly.
Seems to be. I just wonder what the standard is in the industry. Do you always have to give an opposing view, even when it's like CDC released a report today that says there's no link between childhood vaccines and autism? Okay, like the fifth study stating that. But why is it TV reporters then say, however, Jenny McCarthy says, a lot of the controversial things that we've done together on Homeland Security, there are two clear sides for the debate. But when we're involving kooks, Well, and you've never done the vaccine story. Well, I'll just be blunt here. Why do you have to give the other side to that story when that has serious consequences?
Well, I think that anthrax actually is a perfect illustration of why we have to give the other side. Because sometimes government doesn't get it right. And sometimes you do need to incorporate an opposing point of view, a skeptical voice. Do we always find the right people? Grant that absolutely we do not. You know, sometimes there's somebody out on the fringe, and there is sometimes a sort of knee-jerk desire to portray a story in black and white terms when sometimes there's only white, sometimes there's only black, and sometimes there's a heck of a lot of gray in between. So it, you know, hopefully we're smarter. Hopefully the people covering the beat know more than they did then about biosecurity and other potentially inflammatory stories. But I think simply the fact we have to second guess the government. It's the nature of the work we do. Sorry, guys. I know there are a lot of government officials out there. Yes.
If there should be a really major event, the media will have a very important role, not just in telling people what we think is happening, but also telling them what they ought to do.
Correct.
Do the media practice for this eventuality, and if so, how?
We did in the immediate aftermath of 9/11 and the immediate aftermath of anthrax. We all printed out CDC guidance and had it on our desks. As I recall, even had some graphics made so they would be in reserve, ready to go if a certain kind of attack occurred. I will say I think that's atrophied over time. And I think the fact that we've reached the 10-year anniversary of 9/11 without a major terror event means that it will probably atrophy further. And you also are seeing turnover within newsrooms. I've left CNN, Mimi Hall, who covered Homeland Security for USA Today for years and was considered one of the deans of that subject matter, has left USA Today. So you have people on the job now who weren't around then, who weren't there 10 years ago. And it does, that also raises my level of concern about our preparation, whether we're read in editorially the way we need to be to handle this well and responsibly. Great. Well, thank you all. Appreciate it. Enjoy the conference. I'll be listening.